assistant stuff removed, and he hasn't, he was, they were waiting for the lab, not for myself, but his wife.
Special business meeting, March 22nd, 2005. We're going to begin tonight with the budget workshop and meeting, which I will be turning over to Kathy. Hopefully, we will receive some additional information, have whatever discussion we need to have, and be prepared to vote on the budget at the, on going to the regular meeting. Another item that has been added is.
Oh, for the regular meeting, is we wanted to have a very brief discussion about the calendar committee met this week. And I know that there are some thoughts on the board as to late starts, early releases, and so forth. Not whether or not to have that common planning time, just what's the best way to make that.
And then finally, the good news is, new superintendent will be arriving at approximately 8 o'clock in the evening. Kathy?
Thank you. Thank you, everybody, for coming, and thank you for all the input that you've all done with the budget. We appreciate everybody's time and efforts, and I know that it wasn't easy to put some of this together. First of all, did everybody receive this packet?
No.
Did they have
no.
One for tonight?
Okay.
And that would be under, as we go down.
All right. Okay, then, but we do have the packets with the questions and the answers from the last meeting, the Saturday meeting, yes? No, we know?
I don't need it.
We distributed them last Friday, and there were, I think, 18 questions, and we tried to provide you the information, and because there was no real directory in there, I just wanted to run through that and make sure that this was working.
Okay, thank you. I think so. That's what we have on our list.
All right.
Why not?
I'll handle what I can and farm out the other pieces. The first section after the list of school board budget workshop questions or pieces of information requested was the expanded list of requests not budgeted. I know that I have an email late this afternoon from Sarah suggesting one more addition. We'll see about that. It was for stipends for. Under high school, $374,034. Nice going, high school.
Thank you, Jeff.
Yeah, you added up, huh?
Thank you, Jeff.
What do you mean it doesn't add, Kevin? Come on. Anyway. We will look at that. She was talking about stipends for people who are helping with the LAS system, and that was not added this year, that was not asked for this year because it was felt that it was impossible. But it was a piece that she definitely feels, you know, down the road needs to happen if we're going to continue to ask these people to give lots of extra topics to develop questions and assessments and scores. The next sheet was from Claire and listed the number of students in each of the resource rooms. This was a response, I believe, to the question of will we have ample people to take care of the special ed needs at the middle school. This totals up to a total of 54 students, cutting down to three resource, for resource rooms, not counting our life skills students. If we reduce to three classrooms, that's a total of 18 students per classroom. That does not mean those students are in there all the time. That is 18 students who are in and out of those rooms when they are not in the mainstream. So the state allows 35 students. So we are still in okay shape. It does mess up, as you know, the team piece, and that's something that Nancy expressed concern about. The next sheet was from Tom Eismeyer, and he talked a bit about the common planning time that they have, the one period per week. And down bottom, I'm just hitting the highlights of this. If you have other questions, we'll take them at the end. But he mentions the Reading Recovery Network. We are at this point recommending that the approximately $10,500 that we need to support, to keep the support system for reading recovery, come out of our federal local entitlement grant. That is allowed now for programs that will help meet the, what's that term again?
RTI.
Response intervention that Claire has talked about with you. You know, because kids won't automatically be put into special ed or referred for special ed, they have to have those response, those other responses first. And because they are allowing use of funds from that money, at least a percentage of that for this, we're suggesting the money for that come out of that fund. Actually, there will be a package for you, and that's a package you mentioned, I think, about all the federal funds and other funds that are outside that will be the council is sure to have for, I understand the ask for last week. The next page is a page from the Cape Elizabeth Educational Foundation, SEED. And in a meeting, we talked at some length about the how and what will be started as far as achievement centers and where over the next few years. It's a 5-year plan. They wanted to get some sense of what it would be. And it was helpful also in our own budgeting as we look at the high school budget down below. The way it's written, the cost of this year's achievement center would be $50,000 from SEEF and $90,530 from the schools. Next year it would be $40,000 from SEEF and $88,000 from the schools. The following year it would increase to $75,000 from SEEF because the middle school achievement at that time. And with a total of $119,000 from the school district. So it does start to give us a picture over the years of what the increase will be. Now this will change. One of the proposals on the table tonight in the budget is to bond the software over 3 years. Should we do that, the bottom line of this would look at 68.5 for this year, 101.5 for next year, or an increase of $33,000. These are new figures I'm giving you. They're not on the sheet.
Yeah.
And $132,000 for the third year, or an increase of another $31,000. So that's one of the things we have to consider when we're thinking about do we bond the software or do we keep it the way it is. Because in fact, if we keep it the way it is, there's actually a slight decrease next year and then a $31,000 increase the third year. I didn't carry it out for all the other years. I thought 3 years is where the cap is in place, and hopefully by then we'll be on a little better ground.
And I have a question.
Yeah.
You said that for this next year would be 68.5 if we were to lease the
68.5
and then it went
to lease.
And that was
and
a 3 year.
And then it goes to 101.5.
So that's a huge increase.
Well,
that's
it's,
where the bill
it's $33,000 for next year. And another $32,000-$33,000 the year after. So it's pretty constant, but those increases are there, and,
yeah.
And the question is the money.
So there's no seed contribution that fourth and fifth year, that's what
they're is. They're contributing $45,000, if you look at the top section,
mm-hmm.
$45,000 the third-year, but that's, they are then helping with the middle school and the elementary school, which would be additional charges starting in the third year.
They're looking for a three-year pull-out strategy.
Right, from each place.
From each center.
Okay, we all right in that one?
Just one other quick question. In the software, it's $35,000 a year. Is that the maintenance?
It is.
$5,000, $35,000.
I think that was a little high, but it was pretty close.
No, it was $1.8.
We thought the same.
It is what it is, it just sounds kind of hard.
And if we drop it down to 12.2 or 13, which is what it is, if another sheet coming up, we still have the 5,000 update piece. The next piece is actually from Pauline, and what it would cost to lease the software versus buy it, I mean, lease it over 3 years versus one page of $35,000. I rounded off to $13,000 on the previous page, 12.2, but it was ballpark, so give you an idea of what the difference would be. The next page, professional development. We were asked what the total professional development budget was for the school system. It is about $129,000. Now, there are some of the state funds that are used for, and federal funds that are used outside the budget, because it's not a lot. But, you know, if you look at this $129,000 and figure we have 160 teachers and 40 ed techs, that's in service for 200 people, which comes to about $600-something per person. Yeah, we have about 160 teachers and 40 ed techs. If you just count that portion of our staff, it's only about $600 per person we're spending on updating their skills each year. We also have some of these monies go to help with improving kitchen workers, improving bus drivers, improving other people who work in the school system. So those aren't the only people who are affected by it. Administrators, for example, are definitely affected by it. But just to give you a rough idea of what the monies are and what it comes out to the person. Next page, we were asked for the ratio of essential programs and services, staffing versus what we have in Cape Elizabeth. Very close. At the elementary level, we are exactly where we are supposed to be, according to that program, 17:1. In the middle school, the recommended is 16:1, and we are 15:1. That's pretty close. And at the high school, the recommended is 15:1, we're 13:1. But remember, how many courses? 37% of our courses are AP or honors or AP, 37% of our courses. Those aren't really covered under this. Now their logic is, well, if those kids weren't in those courses, they'd be in some others. Our kids are in all kinds of courses, and some of them take whole numbers because you don't offer a French 4 or a French 5 course and have, 20 kids in it. There are only so many kids who are taking all those courses. So there are good reasons for the numbers to be slightly lower, the ratio to be slightly lower than you take. And in other districts that want upper-end courses for their kids.
My question, which I don't expect to have an answer tonight, is what's the percentage of courses targeted to special ed module students? I don't expect an answer tonight. And I don't need an answer in terms of the budget, but I do want to know what the number is.
I can get that easy for you.
Okay, thank you.
The community services, we're asked for all of the salaries of the people in the main office there. Sue will be with us a little bit later, at a meeting earlier, and will be joining us, but she is, has provided this for you to make sure you knew what those hours were. Keith, on the next sheet, provided you with the budgets for, boy, that's a great presentation. Thanks. But in fact, we have lower expenditures for athletics in Gorham, Greeley, or Falmouth. And I'm sure there are other districts that we could look at, but that was a first blush. And I think there's one more piece of information coming tonight in the second, tonight's information from Keith.
Yeah, is that the student too, the contact from the kids that participated in the...
Yeah, I think it's a per student piece that Keith has.
I have the student, cost per student for Falmouth, that was the only one.
A lot of districts don't do that, so it's not an easy number to get. Next was a piece from Nancy, and it was a several page piece that talks about cost of common planning time, student load, planning time, structures for other area middle schools, and how we differ. And I won't go into detail on that, but, you know, if you read through it, I think it's a pretty clear explanation of what's in place there. There was then a memorandum from Pauline with backup of an email from Jeff Miles, the Coordinator of Education and Technology for the Department of Education. I'll just highlight a couple of pieces here. In the second paragraph on the memorandum, $397 per student is the targeted funds for 9th and 10th graders. Okay? And that's how they figured out what they gave to each district. The first sentence of the second paragraph, $397 per student for 9th and 10th graders. That comes with our student count of 149 and a half. I'm sorry about the half thing, but, you know. And the 146 students for 10th grade, it comes to $117,313 that they say we need to provide 9th and 10th grade technology. And that's basically laptops. When you figure that we only get 17.75 of that because from the state, because the rest is local, then the figure on the last line of that paragraph, $20,823, is the best calculation we can give you as to what are we really receiving for 9th and 10th grade laptops that we might be asking the council for as money from the state specifically for that purpose.
And do we have we yet to receive a completely clarifying statement from Augusta that says that the targeted funds are targeted funds?
Well,
so we can
have
make the
that,
case.
But we, if you read the memo that's behind it, it is clear that those are the money for 9th and 10th grade laptops. That's why they didn't have the formula they have, and that's why they're recommending that money. Pauline then took that and calculated it for our number of students, and, you know, the same number of students they put in our EPS formula at 9th and 10th grade levels, and that's the money that we are actually getting from Augusta to help us with those targeted funds. Is it the only thing it can be used for? No. And that's a piece that isn't clear. Are they pushing to get schools to do one-to-one computing? Absolutely they are. Pauline and Gary and we have one of two of them went to a workshop today to try to get more information, and it was a rematch of the same stuff.
So let me understand this correctly. In theory, that money may have been pledged back to the taxpayers. we get the money from the state, the money gets cut off from the other end of the budget. So we, in fact, don't have the use of the money. So we don't technically spend it on laptops, and next year they take the money away from us?
They could. We don't spend it on technology. They take it away next year. That's what we've been told.
So.
They're not going to, I'm sorry, go ahead.
So the potential is that we get the money, but we don't really get the money, and then they take it away from us.
Right. If you don't spend it for the reason it's called targeted money, if you don't spend it for what it's targeted for, and there's other targeted money for in-service, you don't spend at least those amounts for those purposes, they've said they will not try to come in and take it away during the year because they won't know if you're going to spend it yet. But once the year is over, they will penalize you the next year.
So we'll take a, theoretically, we might take a double hit in the second year.
What we heard today is that the state will be putting together guidelines on how your technology plan should look and what the targeted funds should be spent on. Those preliminary guidelines won't be out until the beginning of December. And they go to the legislature by January 15th.
So 7 months after we adopt this budget, they're going to give us guidelines to live by.
Correct.
And then come December, they will follow their normal suit, and it'll be another 5 months before the actual guidelines arrive. So in theory, we won't have the guidelines for this year until we're submitting our budget to the council next year. You don't have to say that's correct. My editorial is over.
They are saying that next year will be a forgiving year. They probably won't do anything to us.
Until we run out of money.
But the second year, of course, it will be in place.
So a forgiving year
means that if we haven't spent the targeted funds in exactly what's in the guideline, that they will not take our subsidy away for that first year.
And if we receive the funds but don't use it in any way form that they designate in December,
they won't go after those funds.
But they will go after them eventually.
They will go after them the second year once we have the guidelines in place and we know where we're supposed to be spending those targeted funds. We will have to prove that we have spent them in those areas. And they gave us a short list of the instructional technology that is part of those targeted funds.
What do you mean by instructional technology?
That's what they're calling it. Student and faculty computers and labs. Educational software. Technician support for instruction systems. I'm not sure what that meant. I believe it was ed tech, if it's in an instructional setting.
But the thing is that they don't count any software or hardware for food services. They don't count any software or hardware for system-wide or keeping records or power school type of thing. You can't count any of that stuff. It's for student achievement software and hardware.
And it has to be something over and above what we're offering now. Say our current technology budget is X. Can we use that extra money to fund what we funded over the last 4 or 5 years? Status quo?
Yes.
But you're not going to have purchases of that over the coming year, in that you've had in place already. And it's definitely for.
Do we have enough to work with the guidelines to make this presentation to the town council?
Well, we keep trying to get more, what we have so far is
We need to make this appeal
I don't think they're going to be changing the targeted funds or the amount set aside for each of those areas. are for what is listed in the memo, so much per 19th grade.
But the guidelines are talking about for the expenditures.
The guidelines.
You've got a little bit of a guideline.
We have to make that amendment based on customer.
And are we going to be making this argument at a budget workshop with the town council, or will this be outside of?
One of the decisions we have to make is whether, you know, what we're putting in, if we're putting anything above 3.3, so what?
Can you refresh my memory, what the, what was it they said, the grant to each other? It was the money that are received as a result of the increase, so they're working at 55%. What else was there?
They were leaving, the bond, any new bond approved by the public outside of that.
Yeah, I'm talking about any new money that came from the state.
Anybody have to tell me where the 100s are from?
I have it. Resolved, Cape Elizabeth Town Council pledges that if the Pulaski initiative is defeated, the council will use to reduce the property taxes of property owners in Cape Elizabeth. 100% of any net additional revenue that the town receives from the state as a result of the June 2004 statewide school funding referendum to reduce the property taxes of property owners in Cape Elizabeth.
The EPS money is not part of that.
I said this very early on in January, and I think it got lost and forgotten, but what we've gotten to now is just talking about targeted funds, and it's really beyond that. We need to perform an analysis between what funding we would get from EPS under our old percentage of the allocation. What is it, the allocation at this year?
17.75.
And what was it last year?
13.something.
That's the analysis that we have to run.
All right.
The difference between those two numbers is the result of the ramping up.
We actually asked the Department of Education to run the figures this year the way they would have run them last year, and they refused.
Well, we don't need them to.
No, well, then the best we can do is simply to run at 13 point whatever percent it was, and subtract the difference.
Yeah, it's a simple algebra.
Yep.
Process. You just say what, you know, you back it
out. I can handle this one. It's a subtraction exercise.
Yeah, you just back out. You just back it out.
Yep.
And frankly, that's the difference in the money we're talking about.
Yep.
Not this is a much more systemic wide change to school funding.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that is where we need to talk to the town council about and help them to understand. We agree, fine, we set up whatever the result of the ramping up, we understand. But unfortunately, we've had rotten timing. We've had the ramp up with a whole new educational funding formula. That is the exercise we need to walk them through. Not this, we have targeted funds for technology. We have targeted funds for in-service training. Leave that, just don't even go there anymore. It's just too complicated. And there's just too much going on in the desert for us to get bogged down in it. The real essence of the argument is, you said it was a result of the legislation that was, the referendum that was passed. That's fine. We've been able to isolate the impact of that. This is the amount of money it is. Everything else that we've received as an addition is a result of the new funding formula. But as a board, I would like us to think about that and agree that that's really where we want to focus.
Well, let's find out what it is.
Yeah, maybe less.
There, yeah.
You've got to be careful because it could be less.
Well, but
I don't think so, but let's do the calculation and find out.
It's definitely not going to take the 10th grade less.
Right, that's,
Okay. And that was a package that you received, and If there are any other questions about them that are in there, if there are any who are here to answer those.
I just wanted to say thanks to all the administrators for putting all that information together for us that we asked about from the workshop. I realize it's extra time, and it was really helpful to see all that on paper, so thanks.
Bob, I just have a clarification question.
Yeah.
On the request not budgeted, do you use an asterisk for new request? Heating oil is not a new request. Fixed salary is not a new request. Equipment repair is not a new request. I think we need to try to come up with a better term to get at which direction to be indicated.
All right, we'll work on that. We were basically trying to specify the difference between items that were not in last year's budget.
Before. I think that's an important distinction as well. I mean, how many years are we going to have to ask for this kitchen equipment before we really need it? Well, I know that, but I mean, when the old equipment
before
is physically demolished because it's not working at all. I mean, I think that's important to know that we, you know, keep chugging along.
I'm serving ground bag lunches to everybody.
So we want
perhaps
for previous requests, different markings for
it's important for people to know that.
And
cost per student for Cape Elizabeth, is that before or after participation fees?
That's before.
And there's no participation fee in Falmouth?
Correct.
And this is per student, not per athlete. Are the number of athletes that participate in the school a particular percentage?
Right. This would actually be per student participation in athletics.
Okay.
This would be per athlete.
Yeah, okay.
Which ours is also. Ours is per athlete.
Okay. So it's apples to apples.
Yeah.
Other questions?
What I've given you is a kind of the cliff notes summary is on the front page that I put together, and you have all the details of the survey on the other stuff. Just a note, we wanted to do students and staff. All they got to the staff, we had MEA on lines and things like that took up a lot of time, more than we expected, and the staff
student surveys in progress, and get that data to you soon.
Gary, any idea why 95% of respondents were positive prior to the program starting and then dropped to 70% after one semester?
There was a few more. I think my timing of the survey wasn't greatest. There was, you know, with all the budget concerns going on, and just before I got the email on the survey, there was a previous email talking about potential budget cuts with, you know, with study halls and supervisors and things like that. So that may have had some effect on it, but my timing wasn't great.
Any survey of students?
Yeah.
Yes, yeah.
Is that a sampling of students, or is that the entire ninth grade?
I'm trying to do the, as many as we can. I'm trying to do the entire ninth grade, also in the English classes, and try to get the word out. And we can't sit them down and force them to take a survey, but we can try to get as many as we can.
Well, I think it would be very interesting, because they would have had it, used it for 2 years, 3 years after.
Yeah, 3 years, okay.
This was from the co-curricular committee. They were recommending some changes, both increases, decreases, and dropping certain stipends. If you look down the list, you'll find some of each. And the bottom line is that it increases our budget by $774. With meeting all of the requests, or pretty much all of the requests that came in, not exactly the levels that they came in, but at the levels recommended by the co-curricular committee. So I thought it was one of the better afternoons I've had with a co-curricular meeting, actually. Well, the bigger thing was usually there's a lot of hassling over how does this compare to whatever, and you have a pretty good system in place that you're estimating by hours that it takes, and people are pretty reasonable about the hours that they request. So it really a pretty clear cut place where you say, well, we have a math team leader because we have, you know, two busloads of kids going to every math meet. Hard to argue with having one math person, and you know, so some of those kinds of things are pretty clear cut. And people on the committee, I think, did a good job of talking out. How does that compare to the high school or the middle school, which are the two different ones, the same thing, and arriving at decisions? So I just and you want to add anything? Yeah.
Can I just ask a simple question? Who's student leader?
That's been a position that's been in the budget for several years, and was created, and given two people a guidance counselor, a social worker, to get a number of students who are interested in the relationship planning, and they actually check the responsibility for organizing, coordinating, or arranging discussion groups. We'll sort of rethink in some of the ways we have, we give students voice and kind of do that, and get the structure. The round tables, and a loop, trying to use the effect of a lot.
I think you have one more to say, I thought it was my first co-curriculum meeting, I thought it was great that we're looking at what kids, just because we just said what kid, what's working and what isn't, so that we can trade off and send the funds to programs that are really successful, so I think it's great.
First co-curriculum meeting, probably since I was chair of co-curriculum, because when I was chair of co-curriculum, it just went up every year, so nice job, everybody, thank you.
I have a question, which level lab coordinator is coming out?
There is only one.
Oh, there is?
At the high school. And Jeff?
Yeah, when we originally put the two mobile labs, quite frankly, we thought it was going to be significantly more time to train the staff. There would be one person who responsible for all the filming and that sort of thing. And what we found was that it was a much easier way to do that. By just having a lab sort of, you know, a couple of people flashing. And it just didn't have a lot of money. So we didn't even need to have that.
Same thing with the ATM room.
Well, the ATM room is a little bit different in that, I mean, right now, the ATM room is a complete classroom.
Yeah.
And we can use that equipment as part of the instruction thing, and it looks like it's going to continue to be and quite frankly, because of different schedules that the contestants have, we have not had to use for the intended purpose of sort of distance learning that we thought. So the use of that, that's the particular way we can use the conference room for the person that's there.
I think so, it's correct.
It does. Although we got a, there's a caution about ATM because there are eight sites that wanted the ATM site around the state, and we'll be looking at the low-use ones, and they may take the equipment away from us as well.
Well, we actually looked at, should we continue that because of the low-use, but since several of our other functions are tied into the ATM system, like our computer networks and whatever, we were reluctant to make any changes that would disrupt those and cause totally different problems.
The ATM is our main, is also our main internet connection for the whole district.
Yeah.
Yeah, you got it.
And that gets heavily.
Yeah, it's just bypassing.
And a lot of the equipment that's in the ATM is heavily used, but it's useful. But there's frankly not a lot of people supporting that. Basically because schedules are different, so different.
So where are the high use, do anyone know where the high use ones are and why they're able to come up?
Maybe up north where remote and traveling is nothing.
Well, particularly where they don't offer second or third years of languages and kids are looking to take those and they can get them from the ATM.
So if they took it away from us, we'd have to put money in our budget to come up with the equipment that we lose from that. It's part of our network.
We have to somehow provide an internet connection, because that's now funded for the ATM.
Won't ask for an estimate yet.
And they know, I've made it real clear that we're on a renovation, and that's become a classroom, and we may have low use this year because of a good reason.
Oh, that was a good one.
Yeah, it's a good
one. Good.
Put on your feet.
Yeah. Well, just in case Pauline hasn't jumped up and down enough, I guess we'll move on to our revenue change.
Actually, I think the next three are for revenue change, town
I don't care about that, I don't care about that.
Now, what's that?
We have to have reading recovery support, I want laptops, I want to lease the software, co-curricular is fine, anything else, no, that's a done budget, I'll be back.
Okay, maybe.
We're in the summary.
Yeah.
We'll put on that down, just in here.
Maybe, Pauline, you could just explain the revenue changes from what we had before.
Okay, the sheets that I've passed out are revisions from what you received in your budget book. Page one is the page one that's in your budget book. The changes there is under miscellaneous revenue, in the original packet, we had Medicare funds at $44,000, I believe. $45,227, they, that was an error, the Medicaid funds are $66,224, so that increases our miscellaneous revenue. The other change on this sheet is the town valuation down on the bottom, computation of tax rate. I have the valuation at 1290. The town manager has changed that to 1294, so that affects our mills raised for education. So on page one, this is our budget at $17,102,204, the 3.3% budget. Without the new debt, the mills raised will increase by 2 cents.
Because it's a formula.
Yes.
And the median home, the effect on the median home, instead of being $16.78, dropped to $3.71.
$3.91.
$91.
Break down.
3.3, it's still 3.3, that's the problem.
So none of that extra income is more than taken here.
It doesn't help our bottom line. It changes what the economy affects.
Just what it helps us.
It helps the taxes. The blue sheet are exactly the same changes, but this is on the budget, including the new debt service we're picking up next year. The bottom line is, the mills raised for education is going up 32 cents versus the 38 cents we had in the original packet. The yellow sheets are looking at our budget with including the 10th grade laptops at $58,500, and what that would do to our budget and the tax rate. First page, which is marked 1A, is what it would look like without the new debt. It would increase our budget to 3.65% versus 3.3. Tax rate, the mills raised would go up 6 cents versus 3.3. versus the 2 cents. The second yellow page is the same, but we include the new debt. And that would go up to 37 cents on the mills raised for education versus 32 cents.
Is the 20,000 in that memo that we got before for laptop, you don't take that from the 58,000. The 58 is the 58 is the 58 no matter what happens, right?
That would be the lease payment for the first year. It would cost us 58,000 for the first year in the lease payment. Each year for 4 years.
How does that 20,000 be spoken in that memo?
That is, and that's where we were discussing, that is the real dollars the town receives for, if we're only looking at 9th and 10th grade laptop, you know, initiatives. That's a real targeted one that we're receiving for those things from the state.
So if the town council agrees that that's targeted,
still only get 17%.
So that is the 17%. So it's 58 minus 20?
Well,
or am I not looking at that right?
I mean, we need 58,000.
Right, but the 20 can be applied against that. So it's really 38,000 that we're asking the town.
That's right.
So it's really not a 3.65%. I mean, we're talking small amounts here, but it would be 38,000 would be the increment, not the 58.
If the town council agrees the 20,000 are targeted funds and do belong to the school department over and above the 3.3%, then we would be asking them for an additional $38,000 that is not a part of the targeted funds.
And there are some other pieces there that we need to discuss later, and that is if we bond the software for the achievement center over 3 years, then there's another 22,000 that could be taken off of that. What we're asking is that.
And where is that figured out?
It's
not that. But then you've got to come up with an additional 33,000
next year. And we're under the cap for 3 years.
Yeah.
So really, it's just,
that's right.
It really doesn't make a difference.
Yeah, and you can hope that next year looks better.
That's always so we're not going to look at it differently.
Yeah. But I'm just saying that those are, you know, the discussions that we expect to have before we go.
Jeff, your meeting that you went to, Pauline, was it only to discuss the laptop EPS monies, or do we have a sense, I remember somewhere that they were talking about there would be three categories that were designated, some sort of performance indicators, some other,
There are three categories. If you look to your printout, this page in your budget, the targeted funds are listed on partway down, and they are for student assessment, for technology resources, and for K-2 pupils.
Yeah.
They give you slightly more money. They count each student as 1.1 student in K-2. They give the allocation that we talked about in technology, particularly for the laptops, and they give monies specifically for student assessment.
So if we were to apply the formula that Rebecca's talking about, we would want to do it for those in addition to...
Well, we would do it for all the monies that are above and beyond.
I think if you're going to make an argument for running a target area, you need to be consistent.
Mm-hmm.
So I wouldn't even focus on the target area. I'd just make it all about your resolution referred to the referendum. Here's what that net effect is. But having said that, we still have our spending there, and that's what they're basing everything on. So I don't know what that net impact is really gonna be once we make that argument, but I think it's useful just to.
But that's why we've been trying to identify at least the targeted money for ninth and tenth grade, and what the state's intent was, as opposed to trying to figure out what K-2 is different, and, you know, because that's where we would be looking at monies for, to support the system, the support system for reading recovery.
The state has very specific intent for the CPS model, so I just think we need to stay consistent. If we're gonna go through this exercise, if we're clear about the intent of the technology, then why do it for each one? I would just say that this globally discussed the fact that the CPS model is, there's some very specific reasoning behind this, and it resulted in an increase in funding because of those intentions.
In addition to the.
Not because of the ramp up.
Right, and we can, we will concede the money from the ramp up, but not the money for the target.
Which one could argue is still not right, because the voters wanted more money spent on education. That's what they voted for.
Well, they wanted the state to spend more money on education, and less than the local.
There are mixed messages all over the place, and the governor has said, you know, 90% of all of the money we get should go to tax relief, and then they turn around and tell us when we talk about the recovery support system, that there's X number of million more in early childhood, therefore you should spend that on, and pay for that system yourself. I mean, we're getting very mixed messages.
Okay, last year, there was a question, I guess initiated maybe by one of the town councilors about the special funds budget, and Colleen has put together a packet for us this year, which will also be included in their booklet. I don't know if Colleen, you wanna give just a brief overview of that, or?
It's really listing all of the special funds budget that we have that's outside of the general fund budget. Some of those are local entitlement, all of the No Child Left Behind grants, the state grant, the PPPD grant that we received for professional development. I think I've included something on food service. I believe that's.
Last page.
It, yes. There are all the grants that are not included in our general fund budget, but are monies that we do receive for education.
I don't think we need to spend a lot of time on that, but we did want to get it out so people could, if there were questions, we could probably distribute it to the council. So if there's a chance, we'll get back to you.
And these are, we receive these monies and they must be spent for specific purposes.
Correct.
We don't really have any discretion over them per se. They are what they are.
The question came up last year, what is this called? What is this? So, this is sort of a, this is what it is.
This is all the detail and more that you.
That's right, all, everything and much, much more.
And usually, because those numbers aren't firm until summer, it's summer at the earliest and fall at the latest that the actual plans are made for drug free schools, much for how those things are gonna be spent and what's needed in the system.
Does the superintendent's office?
Usually they're.
Use spend to say, or approve their spend to, like, for example, the title IV aid, the support program, 5 and 5 and 5.
crunching them.
Yeah, I know, they do.
2D.
You know, as another committee, and has to fall within certain guidelines, and in some cases, has to fall in as part of your overall plan for your school system, and as part of that work.
So, like, for example, for that one, is there a committee that's done that? I'm just curious.
There is an application process, and in the application, it states what you will be spending it on, and what budget you have to spend that on.
So, can a teacher apply to that?
No, those are not, they're not teacher applications. That committee has to decide how that fits into the entire school district's effect to prevent violence and stop drug and chemical use.
So, what committee is that specifically proposed by?
I don't know, and because it was done before I got here, does anybody?
Tom is.
That's $7,000.
It's been in and out of usage.
Say coalition.
That participation line, so it's really been. It's also a big part, but they're not grants where you can simply give them to one.
So, more was for my own education.
Yep.
I didn't know that we had a committee that did that. I mean, I think it's a valid thing, but I'm wondering what's happening. I haven't heard of anything. I kind of want to know from my own personal.
A big chunk of the NCLB money goes for reading coverage.
Well, no, this particular title one.
Says we spent $7,189.
I'm curious if we didn't have DARE, like, I'm very interested, where did that money go?
I know one significant chunk of it goes to high school.
Thank you, I didn't know.
I will get copies of the plan and get it out with you.
I don't need to deliver it, it's more like, I'm kind of curious to know what we're doing in this arena.
Sure, that's why it's good that this comes up, and I'll get copies of that plan.
The detail does spell that out, where the money is spent.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay, all right, sorry about that.
Any other additional information that people have brought or people are looking for? No, then I think we should be, well, I don't know, but I guess we'll start by opening up for discussion. Bob, maybe you want to help me with this. There's several items that we need to decide for what we're going to deal with in order to vote on the budget, if we want to.
And we've only.
Or not.
We've only listed.
Never mind.
We said Kevin.
We're on the superintendent.
Right.
Hi, Alan.
How are you? Good evening.
Kevin's out there waiting.
Oh, he is.
Yes.
Come on in, come on in.
Oh, well, he's lost.
Mark knows the building well.
Cheek to the house, boy.
Under the five mark. That's how we get out of here.
I was going to say, that's how we're wrapping up the day, right?
Boy, that's a good idea.
He's probably behind the plastic wrap that guards the office.
Thank you very much. Very excited. Good to see you again. Not my Girl Scout cookies.
Yeah, that's true.
How are you?
That was a good study, that was the first thing I said. We didn't show that the IGA any black girls.
Good to see you again. Does everybody know who?
Yeah, I was going to say, wait.
Well, matchup maybe. Alan, before it should be.
Go ahead, Ann.
Well, I mean, I'm sort of waiting for Kevin, in the absence of Kevin, where, I don't know, I mean.
Was gone, we didn't.
We had to greet you. At quarter of eight, we told him he had to go out to meet you.
Well, I've covered the whole building, I've seen the whole building tonight.
But we would like to.
Mr. Fletcher.
But we would like to formally welcome Alan to our school board, and I think all of you have met him through the, or I think all of you have met him through the interview process, and we're just really delighted to have you join our school district, and to be able to have you come this evening is just such a surprise. I think everybody is very excited to, that you're going to be able to attend.
Which just happened to hit it just right. It had me canceled, so I didn't get out of town.
We were just working on the budget, which we're just starting to have a discussion on, and Kathy, our finance chair, is leading that, and then we're going to go into the meeting.
Okay, very good.
Just have one piece of paper.
One piece of paper.
The rest of us have trees. Wendy, we were starting to have a discussion about the discussion that we have to have in reference to what we're going to decide to put in or not put in order to decide what we're going to adopt for a budget tonight, if we're going to adopt a budget tonight. So the items up for discussion are the region recovery support, laptops, leasing the software, buying it, co-curricular, or anything else. We've covered some of those pieces tonight, but some of them have financial implications, so.
First of all, are people comfortable having been recovered and support picked up by our federal monies?
Just to clarify, I am, but just to clarify, are we losing anything?
No, we're actually gaining a little bit of.
I did try to call the state to find out how much they would project that we would be getting for an increase next school year, but the individual who would give you that information has been Hawaii.
So I didn't think you'd pay for me to go to Hawaii to talk to you.
How much was that increase?
But I suspect that we will probably get close to 50,000 increase, and we can use 20% of the new increase for regular ed initiative. And in the past, we've used it to fund after-school homework clubs and things like that. So we have tried to use that increase to be innovative in helping regular ed kids.
So as long as another population is losing some.
That's right. It's not a flat-funded piece. And the other part of that is because a fair amount of what we're looking at for reading recovery and other teachers that certainly can come up with training courses, even in the full 10-5, whatever it might come out of it, 20%. So we felt pretty comfortable doing that, I thank Claire for bringing that up, and Jeff and other people who talked about it.
Another thing that's nice is we can use those federal dollars to do professional development in for anybody, as long as we have some special people involved in the development. So, and we have opened up a lot of money to invite people to participate in professional development.
We have the money in the budget for the ninth grade. We're picking up the other portion of the ninth grade lesson.
Kevin!
Sorry,
good
Kevin.
To see you.
Know what this means in Italian?
You're on camera.
No, it doesn't mean. No, you can say this on camera. Two fingers you can use on camera. Welcome, Alan.
Sorry, Kevin. Somehow we miss each other.
No, you see there's a plot for replacement.
Almost
and this
worked.
Is just another piece of the plot.
I'm amazed he found his way through the school and found this
Well,
way.
So am I.
Well, I did see the whole school, so that's all right.
Yeah. What did you do, follow every car? Because I was out there.
I went to the pool at one point.
sat down in the truck, and then all of a sudden, there was car after car, and he said, you know what? He's going that way. But I did get to speak with somebody's husband.
So he's out there in the parking lot?
Not at all.
Oh my God. No. Okay, well, we'll just. I've lost control of this meeting.
Okay.
Laptop. back to laptops. Anyway, laptops obviously are a piece. Are we including them, aren't we including them?
Right now, we have 58,000 in the above and beyond the 3.3%. There was an interesting discussion at the end of the calendar meeting, I think it took place, and Jeff and Mark can correct me if I'm wrong, but it was sort of over priorities and importance, what's most important for high school and those kinds of things. What I've heard tonight so far is that people are pretty comfortable pushing for those funds to come from the council. Maybe we just leave it there. Maybe there needs to be a longer discussion. I'm not quite sure of what people wish to do.
Is it 58 for ninth and 10th?
No. Ninth grade is taken care of already.
Okay, so it's incremental.
We actually came up with the money to pay for the fee. What was Steve's portion of the ninth grade last year? What, the 58.5 is strictly for the 10th grade.
My feeling is, I think we should go to the town council outside of the public regularly scheduled meetings and have this discussion. And then I would propose that we come back. If it's a negative, then we need to sit down and reassess what we do with the current laptops and how best to utilize them at the high school level. Have that discussion. Then you never know whether there's an education foundation out there that wants to step up, or whether we make a decision that we can't even afford to accept a gift from the education foundation because we might not be able to commit to the 3-year lease on something like that. So I don't want to feel the need to have that discussion tonight until we make the effort.
Wait, Lance, so are you saying that if we don't get the funding for the 10th grade, then we would come back and talk about what we want to do with the current 9th grade?
Or for funding the 10th grade, or both.
As a program.
As a program.
As a program in general, not...
So you're talking about coming back and talking then about the whole laptop program?
Right.
Not in its entirety.
I'm not interested in getting out of backing out of a lease or anything. I just think we, as a district leadership team or the high school or whatever, needs to talk about what's the best way to use the current laptops if we can't continue the one-on-one initiative.
Or do we have other models?
And your proposal is to fund the laptops, but as a separate item, outside of what we're looking at in the budget, because, you know, it's in here.
But you're talking about the yellow pages. You're talking about the pages with the laptops.
She's talking about the white and blue page, and then looking at the laptop piece separately.
That's a good point. I mean, you're basically asking what we're going to give the town council. We're going to give them the white sheet, the blue sheet,
the green, purple, or but are we going to do it at the 3.65%?
I would do it at 3.3 plus.
That's what I'm asking.
Yeah. Laptop. Yes. As a charge of money.
I want it to be 3.3.
Yep.
Yeah. We've done what they asked for. The information we've done from the state.
So is anybody disagreeing that they want the laptops to be considered as a separate piece, but a piece on the left?
Oh, I'm not disagreeing, no. That's exactly how it should happen.
Okay.
I want a 3.3% budget that does not open the door to conversation about the 3.3% budget. I'm more than willing to entertain conversation about the laptops.
And I forgot to mention, too, that Pauline has her computer here, so any changes that we might make, she can then put in there. We don't have to take off our shoes to count it. The computer will calculate it for us, and we'll be all right.
Following up on that question, I agree with the strategy. We go to the town council and they don't approve it. We come back and come up with a different strategy on how we use all the laptops. I know that there's nothing extra in this budget, so I don't use the term extra. But are there potential items in there that we're willing to trade for the laptop?
Yeah, it's an interesting discussion, but I don't think we need to go there until we know.
Okay.
That's my opinion.
I think we have that discussion.
That's probably.
Yep.
And cross our fingers and hope we never have to have it.
You're done.
Okay. Okay, leasing the software, leasing versus purchasing.
We've looked at both, and when we look at the bottom lines on those figures in our package, that package we were going through earlier, I get concerned about the increases of $32,000 each year with when we're still under the cap. If we are going to leave the laptop in one piece, I would tend to plan to pay for the software upfront and have a little bit of wiggle room, particularly next year, because you would have a $2,000 decrease next year in what would be expected for the Achievement Center. And that would at least give you a little bit of breathing room. You know, there are some other pieces. We have seven retirements so far this coming year, for this year. We don't tend to make out better on retirements. We tend to break even the year that they happen. The year after, we tend to make out a little better. So that might leave you a little more money. But still, we went hunting for every piece of, or possible piece of money that would not need to be repeated next year. And it was hard this year. It's going to be even harder next year because we've tightened up some of those places. I think the only other thing you have in the budget that won't have to be duplicated would be the $10,000 for the NEASC accreditation. So you don't have a lot of money, I just suggest at this point you need it and not go on. So when we want to look at it again, but we have to come back to look at things and maybe we can do that.
When do we need to execute the lease?
Colleen?
When we determine that we want to purchase, that's what we want to do. When do you need the programs?
By September at the latest.
September 1st. We'll probably do it in August.
Realistically, the beginning of August would be the latest.
So my point is that we can accept Bob's recommendation at this point. We can always change it based on what happens with the budget.
Any other questions or thoughts on the leasing of software? Okay, post-curriculum, we have this on the road. This was a recommendation by the post-curriculum committee. I'm understanding what Bob said. We can vote to adopt this, and it changes our bottom line by $7,000, correct?
That's my laptop.
I don't think so. It's going to be a GPS system for you.
Remember what they say about payback. And remember where I grew up. They don't have to grow up.
So the question before us tonight is, do we want to adopt
line by
we want to reduce the line by the $774. It is. I mean, I think we want to take that recommendation. Well, I mean, it's up for discussion if somebody has a...
Does anybody have an objection? Because we can't take the workshop.
Right.
need, would that buy one with a burger for the store?
Yeah, really?
Well, that money's not leaving the budget, we can spend it.
But it's still part of the bottom line.
Actually, you may want to leave it right where it is at this point, the budget and the
It comes back to the bottom line, we're gonna vote the bottom line and what we do with it is up to us.
I just don't want to change that.
No, he's not getting his GPS, so.
So we should take a break, Bob, or should we?
We don't need to make any changes, I don't think, so I can get ready to move on to the bills.
Do we have to change anything in terms of the meeting?
So I'll close out then, I'll close the workshop and you can take over for the.
In that case, the workshop is closed. We are now in a special business meeting to take the school board from March 22nd, 2005. First order of business is closed, is adjustments to the agenda.
That's the.
Henry?
Hi.
Okay.
Okay, let's see if we can discuss before you meet. Okay, I think I'd like to get the budget out of the way first.
Okay.
Can I have a motion?
Can I, since Pauline gave me the figures that she just recopied, I'll do that. I'd like to make a motion to vote on the 2005-2006 budget to approve in the amount of $17,502,204, of which $3,220,104 is additional local funds, which exceeds the state's essential programs and services funding model by $1,320,084.28. The school board recommends $1,320,084.28 for the following reason. The state's funding model does not support all of the costs of the schools because it includes only those costs considered essential by the new state essential programs and services EPS model.
I'm glad you did that.
Just off the top of my head.
Yeah, right. So everybody understands, there must be, under the new EPS model, there must be a motion that includes not only the amount, don't even go there, not only the amount, total amount, but also the amount that you are above the EPS model if you are above, or the amount you're below if you are below. And that's why it was worded that way. The motion that the town will vote on, if you remember, there used to be seven different questions, two of them dealing with voc ed, and now there will be five different questions that they will have to act on. Am I correct? Five?
Yes, five.
But, you know, for our purposes, we can roll it into one question as long as we include both the total amount and the amount above EPS.
Henry, will you move on in a second? Any conversation? Seeing none, all in favor? No, go ahead.
No, it's fine. I was just saying, I haven't had a chance to say it, but I really do appreciate what you guys went through this year. And, I reluctantly approve.
Anything else? All in favor?
All
Motion carries seven zero. Do we need to adopt the motion to request the laptop phones outside of our budget solution? Should we? In that case, who's got the dollar amount for the laptops? Can I have a motion that we request a total of $58,500 from the town council outside of our normal budget to fund the 10th grade laptop program? Thank you. Give me a second. Conversation or comment?
Is that of the targeted funding? You might want to add that, you know? Maybe we're going to include that in our traffic, in our press, we'll address that. I'm not sure.
$58,000, you know what?
Right. And they have the final say on whether or not to get the state funds.
Okay.
Are they burning the cement floors?
This is a typical day in the high school.
Let me be clear, we're asking for $58,500 for 10th grade laptop outside the 3.3% from targeted funds.
Kevin, could you tell me who made the motion? I didn't hear.
I don't know.
Henry.
I got the second. I just didn't get the motion.
Oh, this is turning into quite a night, isn't it? All in favor? Opposed? Motion carries seven zero. Next item on our agenda is want to do calendar discussion, or would we like to elect our superintendent? Since we don't have a formal agenda, I'd like to elect our superintendent. First, let me say, as I want to thank everyone, particularly the school board members, for the long hours that were invested in this. Certainly also want to thank everyone who was involved in the process. Special thanks to Bob, because it was a pleasure comparatively doing this year, with the ability to seek assistance and guidance from a superintendent. It has been a long task. The decision was made this morning. Alan has graciously accepted it and signed his life away on a piece of paper that Bob has
stowed away.
In a place that will never be revealed. May I have a motion to elect Alan Hawkins as the next superintendent of the Cape Elizabeth School Department with effect on July 1st, 2005? Thank you. Give me a second. Thank you. All those in favor? Opposed?
When Kevin called me today, I was in the middle of the high school guidance office with the principal, the two guidance counselors, and the secretary dealing with a student who was right off the walls. And I just became off the walls more than he did, was all the time. But I really have to say to you that from the perspective of a candidate going through the process here in Cape Elizabeth, it was a very, at times, challenging process. I'll be the first to admit that. But I think an excellent process, because I know for me personally, and I'm sure for my fellow candidates, it really stretched our thinking. And I would leave here every time and go back and, you know, rethink and think about what you'd asked me and what effect that had on my current superintendency in Wisconsin. pass it, but also if time came that I was coming here to keep Elizabeth White was in here. And I have grown more and more and more excited every time that I've met with each of you and had an opportunity to get to know the Cape Elizabeth school system. Even though I was in South Portland for 30 plus years and we're just across the border from each other, we're two very different school systems. And I look forward to the work that I'll be able to do here for the next few years. I will tell you that your vision of where you want Wiscasset to be is exciting. It is nice to know that even though there are times when you feel like you're really having to push the envelope as far as what's going on with the town council, what's going on with the state, what's going on with the federal government, et cetera, you still have a clear vision of where you want to get to, and that's extremely important. And one of the things that several people have commented to me as they've known, since they've known I was a candidate, they've asked me questions about the Cape Elizabeth Education Foundation, which I think is an amazing program for a town that shows the support there is. You have amazing support out there, even though there are probably pockets like there are everywhere. You have amazing support for your educational programs, and I look forward to working with each and every one of you to continue on the road to making this the very best system in the country, and I will do everything that I can to do that. And so I thank you very much. I thank you for allowing me to go through the process. I thank you for selecting me as your superintendent. My head is still spinning. I will be the first to admit that. And my biggest concern right now is going back to Wiscasset and letting everyone know that this has happened, because 2 minutes before I got the call from Mary and then Kevin, two teachers stopped me in the hall before I went into the guidance office and said, "Have you heard anything yet?" And I said, "No." And then they're going to think I was lying to them now. But it's also a very difficult situation when you're leaving a system where you have worked very hard and thoroughly enjoyed. But I look forward to this. I look forward to the challenge. With the permission of the board and the interim superintendent, you will see me frequently because I will attend board meetings. Just so, and luckily you do it on Tuesday night and we do it on Monday nights. So I'll just do two board meetings in a row each time. But it's important for me to get to know how board operates. It is important for me to get a chance to talk with each of you individually, from business manager to within the schools, the administration, the teachers, et cetera. So I will be around. I won't be a pain until after July 1, but I will be around and get a chance to see how things are going. So I thank you very much, and I'm really pleased that I could get here tonight on such short notice. So thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
The last item on our agenda is a discussion of the calendar, in which I'm going to turn over to the chair of the calendar committee.
Well, following the nomination for superintendent to the calendar committee is really a bit of a letdown. Could I just make one comment, though, before we jump into that? Because I really wanted to express a thanks. To have all of you express a thank you from the board to all of your staff for that, really the tremendous amount of support that they gave throughout the entire process and the support that they gave to us, and really the concern and the interest and the passion that they showed in all of their surveys and the phone calls that we've received and just the help throughout the entire process. We listened to that. We were really glad to have that, and I mean, it really was a process that included, you know, the whole district, but I really want y'all to share our thanks to your staff for helping sort of see us through it all, because it had a big impact, and we appreciate it, and I'm sure that Alan, you know, will soon learn to, you know, see what we're talking about, but I really wanted to get that message out.
It's true.
Yeah.
So bringing us way down to the calendar committee level, the reason that we just wanted to just have a real quick discussion about that tonight was that the school board got our first email yesterday or this morning about the late starts. Maybe the first and only, possibly the first of many, but it just sort of got some of us talking about it. And I'm not going to do a full report on the calendar right now, but I mean, we went through all the the usual details and considerations. But of course, the late starts are the thing that gets parents going the most. And so what we thought we would just like to do is just sort of be, you know, a little bit proactive, get some feedback up front from the whole board before it gets to the final, you know, stage in the school board meeting where we're voting on it, or at least seeing it formally, you know, for the first time, and then voting on it the next month. And, you know, we want to get the message out that it's not in any way that we don't want to have, you know, Pond Cove and the middle school have that time in the morning. We recognize the importance of that, you know, we want you all to have that, we have to have that, but what's the best way to get that? Is the late starts the best way? Do we need to think about early releases? Is there another model? You know, there have been other models tossed around with 15-minute late starts every day, adding up to an hour and a half at the end of the day. I mean, we kind of want to put it out there to have the discussion now, before it sort of gets all on paper, because I think, you know, there are some points on it. And how do we, you know, do we put a letter in the Pond Cove? I think it's probably Pond Cove parents' time, and you can correct me, but that might have the biggest concerns with it just because of the age of the kids.
It's a supervision.
They can't stay home alone. I mean, it's not nearly as big of an issue for middle school kids, and of course this doesn't affect the high school alone. But, you know, what do we want to do with that to get, do we want to sort of actively get input or what? So just kind of wanted to have a brief, you know, board and other input on that at this stage of the process.
Can I ask this is probably very good. We have to have the same number next year. I mean, with everything up in the air for the assessment, and we've made so much progress this year, are we maintaining the same number of late starts?
It actually comes out slightly less. What we're looking to do, and just get them to account for a little bit, is to try to make them more consistent, that they be every other week, as opposed to, you know, sometimes we had two in a row and then we didn't have a couple because of whatever reason. We're also looking at the possibility of changing them to Mondays as opposed to Wednesdays, so that they were, you know, right after the weekend, as a suggestion from some parents early in the year.
But the need is
the
still
same
ongoing.
The need is still ongoing. Not only are people going down to continue to develop assessments, and by our next meeting, I believe we'll have a list of all of those assessments that have been developed, Sarah, for the board, and it's huge. But in fact, now they have the school. You know, they just, they still have to do it.
And I
so
think
that's part of our communication. Originally, yeah, the message to the public was, this is sort of a temporary, if it becomes entrenched, I think we need to say why. And I guess my question is also, with everything that's being discussed about how onerous this whole task is, by keeping them in there, we're going to stay the course. We're going to stay the course we're doing. We're not going to say, Cape Elizabeth is still going to keep going in this course, whether we're overdoing, underdoing.
One of the things, too, about the temporary part, I think part of the reason we thought they, if somebody thought they were temporary, it was because, remember, we did late starts because we couldn't afford to hire the extra staff to do it another way. It wasn't that the need for the common time together was ever going to go away. It isn't going to go away.
No, but that's a different thing. If we're then transitioning to use it to common planning time, which I support, parents need to know that it's not the local assessment.
But the time, it won't actually ever, the time that we're using on the assessment, we'll need that time to work on those assessments forever. They're dynamic, they're ongoing. It will never be finished. Once you have one and do it, then it's about time to recreate it and do it. So, but the temporary part about the late starts last year when we did it, one of the reasons we put it in is because we didn't have the money to hire the extra staff to get that kind of time. This time has actually worked to our benefit more in freeing up more of the people that we need, more than we, which was part of what I wrote to actually now really do it the way is best to do it. It would cost us even more than we originally thought it would. So that's the only temporary
So Nancy, so you're saying that what we're doing now with the late starts is actually better than some of the other options that you presented a year ago?
Absolutely, because you have all the grade levels free at the same time, and you can do common grade level things, but you can do cross-content things. All the math teachers can get together, and there is no way we would have all the math teachers free at the same time.
So I think that's a communication piece that Tricia's like. So what we're hearing is that this is actually probably really not temporary, that...
Right. Actually, on the brochure, the calendar brochure that was distributed last year, on the back part of it, it clearly says this is a temporary, and the phrase was, this is a temporary solution to an ongoing problem.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
But so people in their heads are
right.
thinking...
They saw temporary, not ongoing.
Four more late starts this year, and then we're going to go back to the way it was.
But I got to be a little bit of a devil's advocate, and I hear what Nancy's saying. And I think maybe a piece of this may be to take a poll, because what I'm hearing is that the parents don't like it. I've heard from a lot of parents they don't like it. But what was an interesting piece is I heard that the students don't like it because it's disruptive. Now, I don't know how many students that is, and that's why I'm saying maybe we need to explore that. I think that we should be looking at some other way of doing it versus late starts every other week. Whether it's, I liked Elaine's suggestion at one point, a 15-minute change in every day so that there is a consistent schedule that happens. It's not conducive for people who are trying to get out because they're working. And I really was surprised when I heard that some of the kids found it disruptive. And it made sense to me. And I understand what Nancy's saying, and I'm understanding the need for it, but I see that we need to weigh this around a little bit. I guess I'm sort of saying to myself, well, maybe we really need to take a poll out there of all the parents in the school to say, you know, how, I don't know how we say it, but how difficult is this? Is this very disruptive?
Well, I think we have to, if we go with that, we would have to present various options because we have to have the time. So we don't just want to get, you know, feedback that, yeah, it's really inconvenient. So
but
we have to present, like, options A, B, and C.
Well, that's why I'm suggesting that maybe you look at, you know, and I don't know if you're still supportive of what you were talking about, but I thought Elaine's idea of starting 15 minutes or 20 minutes later every day and then schooling it together. Or
an hour and a half.
Right.
On
a designated day. So
it's consistent
then?
Schedule. Planning time. And it would be after the kids are released from the school. So it would be a major change. It would be a change for those teachers who would need to stay after. Now, I understand that there's been some feedback at some sort of
one
level.
One of the concerns I would have with that is, at the same time you're asking teachers to stay and do the assessment work, you're also asking them to coach and advise activity. And especially at the middle school, our students aren't really able to go home for an hour and a half and then come back for an activity or a sporting event because they don't have transportation. So therefore, your other option is, well, then the people who are advisors or are coaches can come from outside the school. We have really tried to switch that back and get more of our school people doing that for some really great reasons and connections with kids. So we don't want to do that. It also isn't really, you don't have your right group of people there. If those people are excused and then they're always missing the assessment work, then they don't have the same participation and involvement in developing and scoring the assessments and all of that really rich discussion that comes from those activities. So I think there's a cost there as well that we have to think of that I know would impact middle school kids. It's just like elementary kids, they can't drive their car and come back later for an hour and a half to do that. Plus, in basketball season, when we're using our gyms, we have some teams practicing well after 7 p.m. at night, and that is something we really try to avoid.
So can we look at some other, you know, can we look at other models?
We're looking at 3 hours a month, right? Approximately an hour and a half, twice.
Every other.
Mm-hmm. So if you had one month, one early release date per month, does that work?
Here's the political thing about early release. And just, you know, as I'm going out the door, so you know what, you don't, I'm really just talking so my colleagues here can think of the best answer, because I know you're really probably not that interested in hearing from me, but anyway, why give them that time to check to think? Over 30 years in education, I have found that early release days aren't as productive
They aren't as productive because students get in their head, society gets in their head, oh, it doesn't count. So I don't have to be there. The afternoons are not as productive for most people in the field of education as doing things first thing in the morning. Our late start days have been productive. We developed a schedule at the middle school where everybody meets, so we don't miss, we know, we can work it right into our plans and it's gonna be a shorter time. Yes, it does cost us instructional time, but we've tried to work that in and make the day be very productive and be important. Teachers are there, they're very productive in the morning and before some of these other afternoon activities, once again, bite in. If you do an early release at the middle school once a month, that's one day that you can't practice, that you can't have an activity going on because then it's hard for the kids to get back there. Or your administrators, they're hanging out around town and so your administrators are never at the workshop because we're always at the pizza place or the library or wherever mediating whatever little issue we need to mediate for middle school kids. And it's nothing wrong with that. They're just kids. They need a place to be. So I have not found that to be productive. But now from the people that you're really more interested in hearing from.
And I think
I have questions before we go any further. How many days a week are co-curricular activities?
At least four. Sometimes
at
five.
At least four or five.
Yeah. If Friday is, Friday we usually reserve for Art Friday. We don't have a bus on Friday. So some of our other things don't, we don't have a late bus on Friday, but Art Friday, office meets on Friday. And our athletics, of course, run on Friday.
Athletics
run on Friday.
So you give them middle school athletics 5 days a week?
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Maybe not. I'm interested in hearing how we can do things, not why we can't.
And I'm not, my argument wasn't meant
to no, I understand.
I'm
trying
to point out what
this.
Some of the opportunity costs are from one choice over another.
And I'd really be interested, Sarah, in hearing your input because you're a pretty good player in this whole, you know, how that time is being utilized.
From the first year that I was here, we had a mix of late starts and early releases. And the feedback during this calendar process, I believe at that time, was that people felt that the late starts were more productive for them. And that's why in the second year that I was here, we found that there were more, there was a switch and there were more late starts than early releases. I think there were one or two early releases. So just from that perspective, the feedback was that the late starts were far more productive for people. At least I think I remember that particularly from the middle school and from Hog Cove.
Now what's your feedback on having, you know, every other week blocks of time compared to once a month block, bigger, but once a month? Are there some implications there in terms of the work that gets done?
I think, you mean having 2 hour and a half sessions versus 1 3-hour session?
Yeah.
I think that the ability to have a continuous strand run through, that having shorter times but more frequent has been helpful for people. This is off the top, I've not talked with anybody about this. One of the things that I hear from teachers around professional development is if there are long spans of time between times that they get to check back with it, there's sort of a ramping up process that happens. And what I seem to have heard from people is that the having a month in between times, I'm not sure how that would impact people. I think that every other week, they get stuff from me every other week. It gets front and center in their mind every other week. Mm-hmm. They have a chance to touch base with their colleagues around, what did we say? Here's what we said we were going to do between the last time we met and now, who's done what, what's happened. There's a consistency to the follow-up, the follow-through. Again, that's all off the top of my head. I haven't talked to anybody else but myself.
Other communities are doing this. And in Gore, they have Wednesdays and have the...
Every every Wednesday.
I think they do that in company.
And I'm just wondering how, what feedback they're getting on their...
It'd be interesting to see, like, maybe a, some laundry list of what different communities are doing and how they're doing it, so that we had an idea of, you know, thinking, you know, if we took some of the schools we compare ourselves to, or even some that we don't, and looked at how are you doing this, just to have an idea of other possibilities. I don't want to make a lot of work for anybody, I'm just thinking.
It just, it sounds like this is gonna become a regular, because we need this, you know, in our district on a regular, ongoing basis, and so we have to get that message out to the parent community, that this is something that we're gonna need long-term, because we really don't perceive this any longer as a temporary, you know, situation. So maybe now, since we now realize that, or at least we're all realizing that, you know, it might be the time to, you know, and not that it can't change in a year, 5 years, but I mean, maybe this is a good opportunity to really figure out, well, if we're gonna have to have this, and parents are just, they're gonna have to support this in some way, what's the best way that we can, you know, meet the needs of the teachers, to give you that common planning time, you know, meet the needs of the students, because, you know, we need to be back. And it's not that we need to be meeting the needs of all the parents, but at the same time, I mean, we want it to work, you know, as well as we can for everybody, recognizing that there are inherent impositions.
The reality is that we're operating under a cap for 2 million kids. There will be no money to do the right solution. And that's my concern. That's what this thing gets me aggravated, is that there's not a chance that we can do anything about this for at least 2 years.
I think we need to let people know what aside even from the frustration of the schedule, I should miss the bus after.
And then when you have kids in high school who don't have late starts,
you're hearing, aside even from the inconvenience, but I think people are now getting beyond the inconvenience of the fact that my kid's not in school for, it's the learning that they're losing as well. And it's all sort of starting to process. I think that's important. Maybe it is the time. I don't know what the best way is. Maybe we have a public workshop night on there. You invite the parents, you engage the community. I don't know. I'm just brainstorming, but we have to share what we know.
Well, we can find out what other places are doing to put together, you know, those kinds of things. How we get it out to everybody and get feedback. And on COVID, certainly have the newsletter. The other two schools don't. We can do something on this through the email groups.
But they felt it now.
I understand. I'm not saying that we can't revisit it and shouldn't, but I think just to give yourself, both of you, credit, you know, you knew this was an issue, you tried to explain it to them, you gave them a heads up, and now it's seeming they haven't done for a year, they're trying to think in. And revisiting those articles, rewriting them in some way, to make them anew, maybe with some new information about various options that the board is looking at, would be a good way to bring it out again and increase work. But the courier is an excellent way of reaching to a client to give them someone, so we might want to consider that.
And oftentimes, the reason why we hear so much from parents, whether the principals do or school board members do, is because people don't necessarily believe that we have looked at all the alternatives. And so that process needs to be very transparent, whether we have a workshop or whether, which is hard because we only get the people who are unhappy come out, or whether you offer an opportunity where people can spend 3 minutes and send someone an email or a survey or something where we can just really, whether we can do anything about it or not, it's the fact that their opinions are being heard, that they understand that we've looked at different
models. Well, another online survey, that's a good for the superintendent class. Yeah.
You can. The question is whether or not you're going to get a response.
You know, it's more about putting it out there and advertising it the way that they know. Whether or not they respond, that's, you know, you can only do so much. You cannot force these people to become involved. All we can do is get that information out there, give them the avenue to provide feedback, and if they don't utilize it and they come ready to complain, you say.
But to do that, we have to determine what the options are that are going to work.
And you have to have a
plan. I mean, we can't just throw, you know, and I don't think a workshop, because I don't think, you know, to just sit around for an hour and a half talking about how inconvenient something is, it's just not productive.
What?
No, frame it around.
Is it inappropriate for me to speak to it briefly?
We'd love to get your ideas.
Where I am right now, we do late arrival days also. When I was in South Portland, we did every type of combination we could possibly do. We do 5 a year, and that's not enough, and I need to be real clear with that. The reason we've chosen to do the late arrival days is basically what Nancy talked about, is it allows kids to stay home in the morning, get to school, and then if there are after-school activities, they can participate in. But I think the point I have tried to make over and over again with our public is, why are we doing it? It isn't playtime for teachers. It's very important time because we are under some very strict guidelines as far as state governments, MLRs, assessment process, et cetera. And then we have that federal piece coming in at us at the same time. So what I have found as a superintendent in Wisconsin is that because 5 late start days are not enough, what I am doing is spending an inordinate amount of money out of federal grants to pay for substitutes. Now then you balance which is the better way of doing it. When you're hiring substitutes, you have got somebody else in that classroom working with teachers. Are you getting quality programming? My argument is no, you're not. When you are doing the late arrival days, you are at least, everyone, like Nancy said, is working together. And my sense is we're working together to improve education. We're not just working together to do what the state says because we believe that we are trying to improve education. And so I think that's what parents need to understand. It's a hard one, and I recognize that. I was a parent for a long time with kids in elementary and middle school. But I think what they need to understand is that that's the goal, is to improve the educational process for them. But it's also, it is looking at it and where can we get the best, I hate to use the term, best bang for our buck, and where can we get the most out of it. And I will tell you as a superintendent right now, I last year spent probably close to $40,000 on substitutes out of my federal funds. And I do not feel it was well spent. We got a lot done, but kids were with substitutes. So is it better for them to have an hour and a half every other week at home coming into school all at once with programs planned afterwards, or having a sub in there for all day long to do some of those things? And those are the issues I have really worked back and forth on. And so next year we are again going to have 5 late arrival days, but we also, we have 183 day school year, so we'll have more full day teacher days than a lot of systems do. But I do think that one of the things that parents need to understand is it is purposeful. It is not just done to give people time to sit and talk. It is very purposeful work, and that's really important.
And
And I think we are making progress in that area. And it may be that through the process, we'll decide we're going to keep the 16 late start dates on Wednesdays. But at least we've gone through the, you know, through the process. And I mean, not that it hasn't been, but I mean, now that we're realizing it's sort of a permanent thing, I think that we have to, you know, make an effort to, you know, to let parents know that, that it has to happen, it's of huge value, and we're trying to figure out the very best way to do it that's going to work for everybody.
Am I hearing that we're going to survey schools that have addressed this problem about budget implications?
How they have addressed it and how they've addressed it, and we bring back all of those ways they've addressed it and decide what we want to develop for options to school, parents or staff or whoever.
So will we include these budget implications?
It may. That I don't think we can include those. I don't see how we can.
Well, that's my point.
Yeah. But I mean, we'll bring back to the board all of the different ways that people are going to support
the board votes.
Yep.
Yes.
Yeah.
When's the next calendar coming?
I think it's April 4th.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
It is.
So will the board see that information before the calendar committee, or is that to be presented at the calendar committee for discussion?
I think it should just be presented at the calendar committee.
What time April 4th, so anyone who's interested in it? I'm sorry?
3:15.
Well, thanks for having the discussion, adding it on, and maybe we can bring my phone.
It's still better than most of our workshops.
This one doesn't beat.
I hope we adjourn. Oh, wait, let me think about that. No.
I know how we can solve all of it.
Okay, the meetings are adjourned yet.
We're wrapping it up, though. It's a wrap, Mary.
Go back. I need to get it on paper, though. I'm turning this on.